Guys, good to see you tonight. Beautiful night. I know we've got a lot of people away, but it's good to have everybody here who is here. So tonight we're going to start with another good-sized piece of scripture. So figures that last week if I talked about how much I enjoy us reading the scriptures, that I couldn't cut it short this week, right? So if you'd stand with me, Ed's going to come and he's going to read us tonight, Hebrews chapter 10.
I am not a King James only. I am a King James preferred. But I also think it's necessary to actually get what's being said. So I'll be reading from the TNIV. And it says, the law is only a shadow of good things that are coming, not the reality themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. Otherwise, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all and would no longer have felt guilt for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offerings you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings, you were not pleased. Then I said, here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, my God. First, he said, sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not desire, nor were you pleased with them, though they were offered in accordance with the law. Then he said, here I am. I have come to do your will. He sets aside the first to establish the second. And by that will, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Day after day, every priest stands in and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. And since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. For by one sacrifice, he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. The Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this. First, he says, this is the covenant I will make with them. After that time, says the Lord, I will put my law in their hearts and I will write them on their minds. Then he adds, their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. And where these have been forgiven, sacrifice for sin is no longer necessary. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of. Some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. If we have deliberately kept on sinning after we have received the knowledge of truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think those deserve to be punished who have trampled the Son of God underfoot, who have treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sacrificed them, and who have insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay." And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Remember those earlier days after you have received the light, when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times, you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew you yourselves had a better and lasting, have better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to preserve so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one will live by faith and take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who believe and are saved. Amen.
Behold the works of the Lord, your life's a story of his love. Come and behold, child, you are known, all the grace that you so be still and know God's in control. He is our ever present. Be still, my soul. See his love unfold. See his love unfold. has never failed you yet. He will never fail you. Give us peace that passes all understanding when we cast our troubles on you. You give us peace that passes all understanding when we cast our troubles on you. You give us peace that passes all understanding when we cast our troubles on you. You give us peace that passes all understanding when we cast our troubles on you. Be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Be still and know God's in control. He is our ever-present help. Be still, my soul. See His love unfold. He has never failed you yet. So be still, my soul. God's in control. He is our ever-present help. Be still, my soul. See His love unfold. He has never failed you yet. He has never failed you yet. He has never failed you yet. He will never fail you. So be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Be anxious for nothing, nothing. Cast all your cares and leave nothing, nothing at all. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. I come up under the yoke of Jesus. His yoke is easy, his burden is so light. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. I come up under the yoke of Jesus. His yoke is easy, his burden is so light. Burden is so light. Take a moment to remember. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. I come up under the yoke of Jesus. His yoke is easy, his burden is so light. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. I come up under the yoke of Jesus. His yoke is easy, his burden is so light. His burden is so light. You're lifting my load. 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 Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. I come up under the yoke of Jesus. His yoke is easy, his burden is so light. No longer am I held by the yoke of this world. I come up under the yoke of Jesus. His yoke is easy, his burden is so light. Oh, his burden is so light. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. Your love carries. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. Your love carries. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. And the darkest places. Oh, all the darkest places. And the darkest places. One more time. Your love carries. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. The darkest places. The darkest places. No matter where I go, no matter what I do, the darkest places. Carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places. Your love carries me through all the valleys and the darkest places.
Thank you for your mercy.
Lord, I don't want to rush on ahead in my own strength when you're right here. Lord, I wanna rush on ahead in my own strength when you're right here. I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. Lord, I wanna love like you. I wanna feel what you feel. I want to see what you see. Lord, I want to love like you. I want to feel what you feel. I want to see what you see. I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. Open my eyes, I want to see you more. Open my ears, I want to hear you speak. Tell me your thoughts, what's on your mind. I'll be your friend, I want to see through your eyes. I want to see through your eyes. Open my eyes, I want to see you more. Open my ears, I want to hear you speak. Tell me your thoughts, what's on your mind. I'll be your friend, I want to see through your eyes. I want to see through your eyes. And I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking. And I'm not in a hurry when it comes to your spirit, when it comes to your presence, when it comes to your voice. I'm learning to listen, just to rest in your nearness. I'm starting to notice you are speaking.
I don't want anything but you.
till you're all I have left. Till you're all I have left. Till you're all I have left.
To all
Every day I will praise. Every day I will praise. Every day I will praise. For you open your head and satisfy desire of faith. My God, the King. Oh, 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 oh.
I want to read Psalm 145, which we've just sung a few lines from, but even though this is a psalm that we read often, I just think it's important to hear it all together. David writes, I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts.
on the glorious majesty of your splendor, on the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand. You satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of those who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord. Let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Thank you, Lord. Tonight I'm just drawn to that one line, the Lord is good to all. And Diane's going to come in a few minutes and lead us in our intercession. But tonight, I just want to ask us to pray. I want to ask us to pray for God's goodness to our enemies. And before you fight, we all have enemies. We all have people that we have been hurt by, are being hurt by, people that we would rather not have to see. And yet the Lord is good to all. We all have people that we would say may not be good people or even worse. Could we just pray for them tonight? That they would know God's goodness and that God would just continue being himself, that he would continue being good to our enemies. Whoever those people are, would you just give them names and name them to God tonight? And don't let the hardness of your heart or the wounds of your heart keep you from asking God's goodness in the lives of those who have treated you badly. Father, I thank you tonight that when we were your enemies, Christ died for us. And so tonight, God, I pray for those that have harmed us. I pray for those who have wounded us. Or I pray for just those that we, for some reason, and maybe our own flesh, just don't care for. Lord, I pray tonight for your goodness in their lives. I pray tonight for them to see you and know you. I pray that you would bless them and that you would keep them. I pray, Lord, that you would provide for them and strengthen them. I pray, God, that you would move in their hearts and move in their minds. I pray that you would protect them from the lies of the enemy, protect them from the destruction of the wicked. And I pray that you would draw them near to you tonight and that they would know your nearness. Father, for us as your people tonight, I pray that you would show us that you are married to the backslider. Show us that you are close to the brokenhearted. Show us that even those who are far away, like we were, you are still near to them. And so tonight, don't let us harden our hearts. Don't let us call people by what we see in the natural, but may we listen to hear what you're saying in the divine. May we not label people by their actions because you did not label us by ours. But may we declare that they were born to know you. They were born to be in fellowship with you. They were born to be redeemed. They were born to be loved. And so forgive us tonight for when we get caught up in how we feel instead of who you are, what your word says, and what we know your will is. Tonight, God, if we're going to declare that your will is that none would perish, that includes those people that our hearts are hard toward. And so I pray that they would not perish tonight. I pray for redemption. I pray for salvation. I pray for the blessing of God upon their lives. Lord, I pray that you would change us so that we could be like Jesus, so that we could pray not just giving thanks that you were gracious and compassionate to us, but giving thanks that right now you are being gracious and compassionate to our enemies, that you're being slow to anger to my enemies, that you are being good to my enemies. Be yourself, God. Be yourself and get me out of your way until you can make me like you. Thank you again that when we were your enemies, you sent your Son to make us your children. Thank you that you've done that for all. Lord, may all come to know you. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for so great a salvation. May it not just be ours. May we extend it to everyone in our path. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. You can be seated. Diane's going to come tonight and lead us in our intercession.
I'm just so thankful to God because he's orchestrating this evening. I just want to tell you that, and I'm sure you understand that because the Spirit of God is here, and we know that because we're gathered in his name. But I just want to thank God because, like, even before Joanne asked me to pray, I had no idea she was going to ask me to pray. And I was talking to God, and I was saying, you know, you look around and you know people are struggling. And I said, Lord, how do we reconcile in our minds what we know your word says and what's happening in our own lives? And then I just know the scripture. And you said, last week I heard you say to Tom, if you don't know how to pray, you don't know what to pray, then you read God's word. So that's what I'm going to do because it kind of goes along with what God was saying. And I really believe he's saying this, to be reconciled. Amen. To be reconciled unto God. And this is his word in 2 Corinthians 5:17-21. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. All this is from God, Amen. Who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And it's like the great exchange that God, through his Son Jesus, has given us himself, that we should have had judgment and wrath and persecution and we should have been far away from him, but instead he gave us forgiveness and mercy and grace, and also he put his righteousness upon us. Amen. That's an amazing thing. And then I says to God, well, would anybody want to be reconciled to you based upon how I live? And I believe that's what he's saying to us too, that a lot of times reconciliation, you don't want to do it because it's scary, because you don't know how the people are going to react. You don't know if they're going to be angry with you, if they're going to shut you out, or you don't really know what's going to happen. But Jesus took the initiative, and we should take the initiative. God's calling us to take the initiative to reconcile with others and to allow them and tell them about Jesus to be reconciled. And like Joanne was saying, well, what do, just pray. Pray as God leads you. Like, and so I'm like, Lord, what's the most important thing? Okay, healing, this, that, the other thing. And I just really felt like it was reconciliation. Amen. And I'm thankful for God speaking like this evening too. And also I says, Lord, do your people, us, like children of God, followers of Christ, do we need to be reconciled to you? Or there are some areas, yes, we're saved, but are there areas in our lives that we need to be reconciled? Like maybe being angry with God or disappointed, or like, Lord, why, like maybe what I desire you haven't fulfilled. And it hurts. Sorry, Lord, you know, it hurts. You know, and what do we do with that? What do we do with that? We be reconciled to God. We have to be reconciled to God. Life hurts. Okay, but even that song about praising God, are we silent? Has that, our situations, our circumstances, our hurts cause us to be silent? If so, maybe we have to be reconciled to God.
Yes.
You know, like, because God understands. So
amen.
I'm just going to pray. Lord, thank you for your word, Lord. Thank you that you made a way for us to be reconciled to you, Lord, when we first believed in you, but also as we continue to grow and follow you, Lord, you made a way, Lord, to be reconciled to you. And I pray, Father, you help each one of us here this night, Lord God, if there's anything separating us from you, like our minds, our thoughts, our hurts, Lord God, our discontentment, Lord God, with you, Lord. Not that you did anything wrong, but we just don't understand sometimes, Lord, when things don't happen, Lord. It's things that we want to happen and they don't happen, or they don't happen in the timing that we want them to happen, Lord. We just don't fully comprehend. But Lord, you know all things, Lord. Lord, you see from above. You see every angle, Lord God. Lord, and you are good and you are faithful, Lord God. And we thank you and praise you, Lord God, for you have put upon us your righteousness, Lord God. Lord, and I ask, Father, for everyone in this room right now, Lord God, that may have been silent, Lord God, and unable to praise you and worship you and give you thanksgiving, Lord God, I pray that even this night, Lord God, there would be, Lord God, a freedom and a healing, Lord God, in the inner man, Lord God, that they would be able to praise and worship you and see you for who you are, Lord God, even during the times that they cannot understand, Lord. I pray for our families that they would be reconciled to you, Lord God. They would be reconciled to God Almighty, even tonight, Lord God. Lord, I pray for the salvation of our loved ones, Lord God. Lord, that even through our lives, Lord God, help us to take the initiative, Lord God, to Lord God, just unite, Lord God, ourselves to one another, Lord God, to forgive, Lord God. You said you delight in forgiveness, Lord God. Lord, that's amazing, Lord, because I don't really delight in that too often, Lord. So I pray, Father, that you help us to delight, Lord God, in mercy, delight in forgiveness, Lord God, to see people as you see them, Lord God, in where they're at in their lives, Lord God, that we would just fall in love with them, Lord God. Lord, that you help us to love like you do, Lord God. Lord, to love, Lord God, those that hurt us, Lord God, even unintentionally, Lord God. Lord, and help us to lay our gifts before the altar and go make it right, Lord God. Go make it right away, Lord God, to do it expediently, Lord God. And Lord, we thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Diane. I'm going to let the kids that are going to go out for Children's Church, if they're awake, go. And with that, I know we're really spread out tonight, but let's just take a minute or two to greet somebody, welcome somebody, and then we will we'll jump into the scriptures. It's so quiet here tonight. I think everybody's tired or something, but it's so quiet here tonight. So thank you guys for being here. So tonight, if you've got a Bible with you, I'm not going to make this easy on you. So we're gonna use three different passages that I pray that we're going to put together. So if you've got a Bible and you want to turn to Exodus 34, turn to Leviticus chapter 5, and turn to Hebrews chapter 10, which Ed read for us at the very beginning. And as Exodus 34, Leviticus chapter 5, and Hebrews chapter 10. So the long and the short of it is this: God is holy. Right? Like that's what we've been talking about these last couple of weeks. That's what the angels are singing. That's what the scriptures are declaring. There's just this reality throughout scripture that God is holy. And so last week we talked a lot about what that looks like. That God's holiness is not the thing that separates us from Him, but it's the thing that invites us to Him. His holiness is His compassion and His mercy. His holiness is His grace and long-suffering, His willingness to forgive sin and to offer redemption. I think far too often we've thought, because God is holy, I can't come close to Him. But I think what we're starting to see is that the scriptures are actually shouting, it's the holiness of God that welcomes you. It's the holiness of God that invites you. It's the holiness of God that makes Him different from every other thing. And the difference is this: He loves forgiveness, as Diane just prayed. He invented salvation. We are sinners. Can't get away from that. Don't need to get away from that. We are sinners, and by that standard alone, we don't belong in God's presence. But God is more, His holiness is more than just moral purity. His holiness is more than simply that God does not have any sin in Him. God is also abounding in compassion. So Him being holy can't just mean God doesn't sin. Him being holy has to also mean, and He overflows with mercy and grace and kindness and compassion and love. That means that we are not only measured by our sin, but we are also measured by God's love. So imagine this: you're not just the sum of your parts, you're the sum of His. You're not just everything you've ever done. You're everything that He is, because He made you in His image, and He made you for His pleasure, and He made you for His glory. So again, we're not only measured by our sin, but we're also measured by God's love and by God's mercy, by His character, by the desire of His heart. And the desire of God's heart has always been fellowship with us. And so in His holiness, it's God who has chosen that where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. God has chosen that mercy would triumph over judgment. God has chosen to be married to the backslider, to love us with an everlasting love. It's God, as we've just been reading tonight in Psalm 145, it's God Himself who decided to be slow to anger and rich in mercy. No one made God, so that's not how they made Him. That's how He chose to be. Imagine God saying, I've decided to be slow to anger. Here's the truth. Some of us would like to be slow to anger, but we don't know how to be. Some of us say to ourselves, I'm not going to get angry anymore. And then the next thing that happens, right? God has decided and kept His word. I will be slow to anger and rich in mercy.
God doesn't have to. He chose to throw our sin as far as the east is from the west. But here's maybe the biggest part of it all. He sent Jesus. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And then Jesus came and took on flesh and dwelled among us. The creator became the creation. John chapter 1 verses 10 through 12 says it this way. He was in the world and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. If God was not holy, he would not care. If he was not holy, he would have destroyed us. If he was not holy, we would have no hope. It is the holiness of God that gave us life, and then that gave his life for us. And again, as we talked about last week, God best defined his holiness when he described himself in Exodus 34, where God says to Moses, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. It's God's holiness that forgives our sin and invites us to be his children. The question that I want us to wrestle with tonight is, how should we respond to a holy God? How should we respond to a God who chooses patience? How should we respond to a God who is slow to anger? To a God who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all? What should we do when we see God for who he is? Because there's got to be something. It's not, you know, we say things like it should change us, but what do we actively do? How do we actively respond? We keep wanting God to do something for us, but there is an action that has to come forth from us when we see God as he is. In Isaiah chapter 6, when Isaiah saw the Lord, he fell on his face and he confessed his sin, but then he said, "Here am I, send me." In Luke chapter 5, Peter fell on his knees and acknowledged his sin, but then he left everything and followed Jesus. In Luke chapter 19, Zacchaeus, with no command from Jesus, openly and willingly just came up and gave half of his possessions to the poor and then promised to pay back fourfold anyone that he had treated unfairly. And so in the scripture, when people saw God for who he truly was, they saw their sin, they saw his character, and then they responded with trust. They chose to trust him. Right? Isaiah said, "I'll go." Peter said, "I'll leave it all behind." Zacchaeus said, "I don't need any of this anymore." What are we saying? What have we said, and what are we actively saying as we see God in his holiness, as we see God in his righteousness, as we see God in his goodness? There is a call to trust him. Now, we generally talk about this as surrender, but surrender is always about trust. Surrender is a belief that not only is Jesus the treasure that's worth leaving everything for, but he's also trustworthy enough to put everything in his hands. I think a lot of us are willing to take a step of faith. We're just not willing to put our lives in his hands. We're willing to go do what he wants us to do. We're just not sure he's going to do what we want him to do. And so we almost do this dance where we're trying to prove ourselves to him so that he'll do what we want him to do, rather than putting ourselves in his hand and believing that whatever you choose to do is good because I trust you. See, I must love Jesus more than anything else, but I must also trust him to love me. We can't know God without trusting him, but we also are never going to trust him until we know him as he says he is, rather than as we want him to be. So if we go back to Exodus 34, where we spent a lot of time last week, where God allowed Moses to see his back or the train of his glory, and then God proclaimed himself as the Lord, merciful, gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. What did Moses do after he saw the glory of God? Right? Because I think we love that story, Exodus 33. Show me your glory. And then God shows him his glory. And we love that. But what we have to do is keep reading and keep going, because it wasn't just an experience. It wasn't something that Moses was just blown away by and then it was just over. There's something that happens because he saw the glory of God. So what did Moses do? Verses 8 and 9 say, "And Moses quickly bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped. And he said, 'If now I have found favor in your sight, O Lord, please, the Lord, go in the midst of us. For it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for your inheritance.'" So let's take a couple minutes and look at Moses' response to seeing God's holiness. First, he humbled himself and he worshiped, right? He bowed himself down, he put his face toward the earth, and he worshiped God. But then he asked for God's presence. Even though he was in God's presence, he asked for God's presence, not because he was afraid that God was going to leave. There's a value there. When something is given and you desire it, you value it, you love it, you keep asking for it, right? And so even though God was there, Moses says, "Stay with me, stay with us. Please do not leave us." And then he confessed their sin. And what's the sin that he confesses? Notice he doesn't confess. He doesn't say we're an idolatrous people. Because sometimes we like to deal with what the actions rather than the heart condition. Sometimes if we're honest, we look at the behavior and we say, "Oh, I don't want to act like that." And God's trying to say, then you can't be. There's something in your heart, because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Jesus says that all manner of evil comes from the heart. And so Moses doesn't say, deal with our idolatry. Moses says, deal with our stubbornness, because the reason that we're idolaters is because we're stubborn. We want what we want. We want it the way we want it, in the time we want it. We are convinced that our dreams are right, our goals are right, our hopes are right. It's got to be done my way. And that's what leads us to all of our sin, is what Moses is saying. Man, how many of us are dealing with the circumstances rather than the heart condition, right? How many of us are saying, "God, I don't want to do this anymore." And he's trying to say, well, then you can't be this anymore. That the reason that you're anxious, like we keep praying, "God, help me not to be anxious." And he says, well, then you got to learn to trust me. We just want to stop feeling anxiety. We just want to stop saying this or acting this way or feeling the anger that burns up in us. And God's trying to say, no, there is a heart issue that I want to deal with, because when I deal with your heart, it'll change all your behavior. We'd settle just for the behavior change, if we're honest, right? Like we'd settle just to not do that anymore. But then we're still the same. We're still far from, we're still, as Diane led us, we're still not reconciled. Because reconciliation isn't a change of behavior. Reconciliation is a change of being. That's why 2 Corinthians 5 makes it so clear. We're new creations. We're not the same old people with new behavior. We're brand new people. So Moses prays, he repents, he acknowledges, he confesses the sin of Israel. And that confession is what? We are a stiff-necked, we are a stubborn people. But then Moses doesn't ask God to take them to the promised land. He asked God to make them his inheritance. Moses didn't say, "Now that I've seen you, take us to the promised land." He said, "Now that I've seen you, please make us your people." When Moses saw God, he realized that the work needed to be done in them. God was able to take care of their lives and their enemies, their food and their water, their journey, and even the promised land. They needed God to work in their hearts. See, we tend to pray, "God, be our God, be our God. Do what you promise. Take us where we want to go." We even tell God when to do things, right? How many times have you prayed, "Do it, Lord. Do it now, Lord." You ever think about how arrogant that has to sound? Like, we want it to be like faith-filled, but how can I command God as to when he should be doing things? It's not faithful to tell God what he should do. It's faithful to trust what God is doing. It's faithful to believe in him rather than command or demand of him. When Moses saw God, when he truly saw God in all of his glory and in all of his holiness, he bowed his face in his heart and he prayed this, "Make us your people. Make us your inheritance." Because isn't that where the work is? Right? God is God. He's always been God. He's always been for us. He's always been good and kind and righteous and just. He's always been holy. But we, if we remember what the scriptures say, we were God's enemies. We were far off. We were the children of disobedience. We went our own way. We hardened our own hearts. Jesus said, and this is the one that hurts the most, we were the children of Satan. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ, for by grace we are saved. It's God who's always been faithful to himself. It's God who came to Adam and Eve and came to Noah and came to Abraham and came to Moses, and then he came through Jesus. He's always been our God. The work is him making us his people. It's that work of changing our hearts and healing our wounds and transforming us into not just new creations, but into his children. It's the work of God to make us his people. That's the hard work. It's easy. God just has to speak and things that weren't suddenly are. God just has to speak and bodies are healed and diseases are changed and money comes and whatever you and I are praying for. The work is us yielding our hearts to God, because he won't just grab us and change us. We have to offer ourselves up as living sacrifices, and then we will be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And so the thing is, we keep saying, God, do this, and God keeps asking, give me yourself. Trust me. If you would trust me, I would change everything. And I'm going to submit this to you tonight. If nothing's changing, it could be because it hasn't been submitted. Because you put clay in God's hands, he makes good pottery. But he won't make anything out of what we won't put in his hands. I think all of this is a trust issue. How many of us are praying Moses' prayer? How many of us are praying, make me yours, make me like you, make me who you created me to be? Are our prayers dominated by seeing God and wanting to belong to him, or by wanting to see God do what we want him to do? Because as I said last week, I'm sure if you polled Israel and they said, you can be God's people or he can take you to the promised land, they would say, we left Egypt to get to the promised land. Take us, fulfill that promise. If we get there, we'll certainly be God's people, because that's what most of us live our lives thinking, that if I just got the thing I'm praying for, it would change everything. If God just did this, I'd be able to be what he wants me to be. I can't be trusting. I can't be submitted. I can't be surrendered, because I don't know what's going on. Not knowing that you won't be any of those things if he told you, because he's God, and if we won't trust him in this, we won't trust him in that. Moses wanted Israel to belong to God. Israel just wanted God to take them to the promised land. Moses was seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Israel was stuck in all the other things. Moses trusted God's holiness. Do we? Do we trust his goodness? Do we trust his holiness in our lives? I mean, isn't all of this what Jesus was teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5 through 7? In chapter 6, that middle chapter, and I'm going to read a long portion of it, but I just think it needs to be read. Jesus said, do not be anxious, or some translations simply say, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? So let me stop there a second. Is not life more than what you're worried about tonight? Whatever we're worried about, and there may be serious things going on, but is not life more than what I'm worried about, what I'm praying for, what I think needs to happen? Jesus says, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to the span of his life? And why are you anxious about your clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear for Gentiles? And remember, in this context, Gentiles means those that don't know that God is their Father. Seek after all these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Jesus is trying to teach us what God was trying to teach Israel. Our lives are already in his hands. We can trust him, but our hearts need some work. Our hearts need his attention. Our hearts need to be submitted and surrendered. So as I just read, Matthew 6:33 famously says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added to you. Our attention is supposed to be on God's kingdom. And most of us, then we say, so what does that mean? My attention is on going to church, or my attention is on witnessing, or my attention is on intercession. And you could say yes to all of those, but here's the real part of this. In Luke 17:21, Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within you. See, the kingdom of God has to be established in our hearts. We have to learn how to trust God and desire God, how to submit to and surrender to God. Because if we don't trust him, we will never obey him. And if we don't obey him, we do not love him. And if we do not love him, how can we think we belong to him? And so there's a lot of us in situations where we're saying we love God, but our lives are not saying the same thing. And so the truth is, if I'm not obeying him, it's because I'm not trusting him. If I find obedience difficult, it's because trust has not yet been what I've grabbed and chosen. And so I would encourage us tonight, you have an obedience problem, you have a love problem, because you have a trust problem. If we don't trust God, we're never going to be able to follow. We're always going to use his name to go our own way rather than submitting our way to his name. Seeing God for who he is calls us to trust him so that he can make us who he created us to be, and he made us to be like him. Moses didn't pray for God to take them to the promised land. In fact, I can't find where Moses ever prayed for God to take them to the promised land. But he prayed for God to take them, but he prayed for God to forgive them. He prayed for God to stay with them. He prayed for God to make them his inheritance. He prayed for God to transform them. He prayed for God to adopt them as his children. Are those the prayers of our lives? If we were to sit down and examine our prayer lives, how many hours are spent on the things that we want, and how many hours are spent on becoming who God created us to be? Because that will show us the level of trust that we have yielded to. Moses prayed, pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for your inheritance. God's answer was this: behold, I am making a covenant. That means that God answered Moses' prayer. Moses prayed, make us your people. God answered, I choose you. I am yours, and I'm going to do the work to make you mine. See, in English, and if you've been in church, you've heard covenant many, many times. In English, a covenant is an agreement or a legal contract. But the Hebrew word that we translate covenant comes with the sense of cutting. It is the picture of two pieces and then the people walking together between those pieces, right? It's like a sacrifice. If you look at Genesis 15, it gives you a good picture of this. And so it's a sacrifice being made. As it's being offered, it's made into two pieces, and then those who are making the agreement walk between those pieces. See, a covenant is a commitment of relationship. It is a mutual devotion to each other. It's not just a promise. It's the agreement that sacrifices will be made, that love will be held, that trust will be given. It's the picture of a costly agreement. Why is it that Jesus has to pay all the price of this relationship? Right? Why is it that Jesus died for us, and yet we find it so hard to give ourselves to him, to yield ourselves to him? We keep saying, but this is the way I am, or this is the way it's always been, or this is just the way that I've always acted. And the reality is, if he gave his life for us, don't we have to give our lives to him? Don't we have to stop acting like he just got the raw end of the deal? If it's a covenant, yes, God has done the work, but the work we have to do is to obey, to yield, to trust, to submit, and to surrender to him. It is a costly agreement to be in a covenant with anyone, but especially with God. I understand that we are saved by grace through faith and not of works, but a covenant is a commitment to do the work to fulfill the promise, to keep the agreement, to choose the relationship, to trust the heart of the one that we are in covenant with. And there are two parts, God's and ours. But what we are about to see is that God is faithful to his part, but he also provides everything necessary for us to be faithful to ours. I know I've already mentioned it a couple times, but I just love the way that Diane led us tonight, because there's this point where a lot of us get to the place of salvation and we think we're finished, when the truth is salvation begins the journey. Some of us are saved but not reconciled. And that may blow some of our minds and say, how is that possible? Because God is gracious. Because God will forgive your sins. God will write your name in his book. And yet you still have not been transformed into his image. And you know what he will do? He will keep his heavy hand upon us, pressing and pressing and pressing. Not because you're not going to heaven when you die, but because you're not living in him fully now. Reconciliation requires trust, because it will require a surrender. God went from the promise of the covenant into the contributions for the tabernacle. Those of you that are still sitting in Exodus 34, God tells them what the covenant's going to look like, and then he starts telling them to now ask for the things needed for the tabernacle. As we talked about last week, the tabernacle was God's mercy to Israel. God had said in their stiff-necked, untrusting, disobedient condition that if he was with them for even a second, he would consume them. Even a second. If I was to go with you for even a second, I would consume you. And yet God says that he would give them a place, that he would have them build the tabernacle, a place for his presence so that he could dwell with them without them being destroyed, which proves this: God wanted to be with Israel. His statement that he wouldn't go with them was mercy. It was for their protection. It was not his rejection of them. But when Moses interceded, when Moses confessed the sin of the people and asked God for forgiveness, not only did God forgive their sin, but he made a way to be with them without destroying them. When we talk about God making a way where there seemed to be no, where there seems to be no way, we should first and foremost always be talking about redemption. A way where there was no way is not you getting the job you were not qualified for. It is not you paying a bill you didn't have the money to pay for. Those things are beautiful gifts of God. But making a way where there is no way is that he saved us when we were his enemies. That he made a way for us to have our sins forgiven when we loved our sins. There was no way for God to dwell among us, but he made a way. There was no way for us to be forgiven, but he made a way. There was no way for us to be called the children of God, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to be made new creations, born again and brand new, but God made a way. There was no way for our names to be written in his book and our lives to be saved from the pit, but God made a way. There was no way for us to have a seat at his table and dwell with him forever, but God made a way. That's what it means for him to be a way maker. That's what it means for him to make a way where there is no way. We know him when he should have destroyed us. That's the only way we should be singing about, thinking about, and rejoicing over. If he can save us, he can feed us, he can clothe us, he can give us jobs, he can change our marriages, he can work however he wants to work, because if he can save us, there's nothing he can't do. And yet some of us come to Jesus and then we watch to see what's next. Instead of realizing, I don't belong here, but his holiness has welcomed me in. God gave Israel the tabernacle so that he could give them his presence, so that he could be with them, never leaving them nor forsaking them. But the tabernacle was not the answer to Moses' prayer. That was the desire of God's heart. God wanted to be among them. Moses prayed, make us like you. Moses didn't just pray, go with us. That was one of his prayers. But then he said, make us yours. Don't just be in the camp, be in our hearts. Make us your people. For Moses' prayer to be answered, God had to make a way for Israel to be with him, just as he was with them. See, that's what happens when we get to the book of Leviticus. That was God telling Moses, this is how I will make you my inheritance. I'm dwelling among you, but I desire for you to now dwell with me. The laws of Leviticus are a holy God inviting an unholy people to be his children. They are God saying, I love you and I desire you. Come to me, and not only will I give you rest, but I'll give you myself. So let me ask this tonight. What if Leviticus is not a long list of restrictions, but it's just one beautiful invitation? What if it's not about us at all? What if we are supposed to see how hard God is working to make us his children? Let's read Leviticus differently. Let's read it and realize this is what it takes and God's willing. Not this is what we have to do, but this is what God is willing to accept, that he is so holy and we are so unholy and we cannot get to him, but he says, I'll make a way for you. Yet again, I'll make a way for you. We read so selfishly. We think so selfishly. We're constantly thinking about and talking about ourselves when the scriptures are saying, look at what God has done. Look at who God is. Look at how much he desires your heart. God's willing to accept our sheep and our goats, our rams and our oxen, our turtle doves and our pigeons, even our quarts of flour and olive oil. God's willing to make a way where there is no way, because as we are, there is no way for us to be with God. And it doesn't matter who you are. Born in church, first week of my life, in church, dedicated, Sunday school, all that, doesn't matter. None of it matters, because if we don't understand that we had no way to God, that church wasn't the way, that baptism wasn't the way, that dedication wasn't the way, that Sunday school wasn't the way, that youth group wasn't the way, that the altar wasn't the way was made by God when he gave the blood of his son. And so if we don't understand that we have no part of him outside of the blood of Jesus, then we haven't got there yet. And I don't want to judge anyone's salvation, but I want us to understand the reality of salvation. If we don't know how great this salvation is, we're not living in it. We're just trying to get to heaven, and that has nothing to do with the blood of Jesus. That's not what salvation was or is. It's knowing that God has made a way. Leviticus is how much God wants us, not how much we have to do to be with God. And it certainly isn't how much we want God for ourselves. So go to that second passage, if you will, Leviticus chapter 5. The chapter begins by talking about our sin. And it's talking about some sins that we commit with full knowledge and some we commit without knowing at all. But all sins separate us from God and have to be paid for, right? What Leviticus 5 teaches, or the first five chapters, they're talking about the unknowing sins and the ones we're unaware of, and we often think we're good with those. Leviticus shows us that you're not. There's still going to have to be a payment made for sin, because all the wages of all sin is death. When we get to this point in chapter 5, God says in verses 3, 4, and 5, so he says it three different times, that the first thing that must happen is we must admit our guilt by confessing our sin. Why is admission and ownership, acceptance and confession so difficult for us? Why is it that for many of us, our first reaction is to explain, excuse, blame somebody else, or defend ourselves? I think it's because we don't know that the realization of sin, the conviction of sin, even feeling the weight or the guilt of our sin is all a gift from God. We wouldn't know we were sinners if God wasn't kind. Because we would just be caught up in our sin, right? If he didn't desire us to be forgiven, if he didn't desire to redeem us, we would never even know that we were sinners. We would just measure ourselves by each other, and we'd always find somebody worse than us. So no matter how bad you are, there's always somebody worse. And so we would measure ourselves and think that we were fine. If there was not any weight that we felt over our sin, we would never, ever know that we had any need for the Savior. So that means every time you and I feel a pang, feel a weight, feel a conviction. I'll even go this far, feel a guilt. I believe that it's a gift from God. See, for us to be with God, for us to be God's children, his inheritance, as Moses prayed, our sin has to be dealt with. It's God who desires to deal with our sin, because it's God who wants to make us his children. It's God who stirs in us the realization of sin because of his love, not because of his anger. So that means every conviction of sin is the kindness of God. It's an act of his love. It's the revelation of his heart. And it's always for our good. See, we don't realize our sin because we want to be with God. God reveals our sin because he wants to be with us. And yet we keep pushing. And we keep fighting and explaining and defending and being afraid that if anybody finds out, or if I acknowledge it, or if I deal with it, then what? Then you can be free. Here's the beauty of confession. David said in Psalm 32 that God's hand was heavy upon him when he was still in his sin, that it felt like his bones were wasting away, and that he groaned all day long. Does that sound like any seasons of your life? Because it sounds like a few seasons of mine. Seasons when I wouldn't acknowledge my sin, even when I didn't know. Sometimes I didn't even want to believe that it was sin, but I just thought life is not going my way, and these people are this, and that's like that, and it's just one thing right after another. And the scriptures are trying to teach us, no, that's the heavy hand of God. That's God saying there are things in your heart you're not letting me deal with. There's things in your life you keep hiding. There's things in your life that you want for yourself. There's things in your life you will not take ownership of, and it's the heavy hand of God, because if it was the enemy, it would destroy you. If it was just the world, it would have no hope for you. But it's the hand of God saying, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Because I'll take my hand off. I'll take the heavy hand of conviction off, and I'll wrap you in the hands of love and grace and mercy and kindness. David said that after he finally confessed his sins, that God forgave him and protected him, that he hid him and surrounded him with songs of freedom. I'll say this again. If your life right now feels like your bones are wasting away and that you're groaning all day long and nothing's ever changing, that is a description of unrepented, unconfessed, untrusted sin. Let's not blame circumstances. Let's search our hearts. And let's let God deal with us the way he desires. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Acknowledging our guilt, confessing our sin, the promised outcome is always forgiveness. Why do we fight so hard to cover up, explain, and keep our sin when God promises that confession always leads to forgiveness, to freedom, and healing? I think it's because we haven't rightly seen God's holiness. And because we think his holiness might destroy us, we don't trust his heart. We still think we've got to figure it out so we can present ourselves without spot or blemish. When the scripture says that Jesus will present to himself a church without spot or blemish. So that means the church, the bride isn't saying, Jesus, we're ready. The bride is saying, Jesus, we submit, make us ready. Some of us are still believing that we have to fix ourselves because we don't trust God. Leviticus 5 says that once the sin was realized and confessed, that it then had to be paid for. A sin offering had to be brought to the Lord. And God said that they had to bring a female sheep or a goat, that the sin offering would be made by the priest for the sin, and that would make the sinner right with the Lord. He made a way to make us right with him. We didn't come up with that. Moses didn't. Aaron didn't. He made a way. If you go through Leviticus chapter after chapter, it's the Lord giving these instructions. I think a lot of times we're like, this is stuff Moses came up with, or this was just for Israel. It's always God. And the Lord said to Moses, and the Lord said to Moses, and the Lord said to Moses. So this is God saying, you're not right with me, but I'll make you right. I'll do the work if you'll trust me. But then you get to verse 7, and God says, but if you cannot afford to bring a sheep, you may bring to the Lord two turtle doves or two pigeons as the penalty for your sin. Guys, this is almost overwhelming to read. It's amazing. It's miraculous. It's unheard of that God would let a sheep cover our sin. But then God in his kindness, the great God of everything, the maker of heaven and earth, the one that is worthy of all blessing and honor and glory and power, was kind enough to say that I will allow your sin to be covered by the blood of sheep and goats. But then he says, but if you can't afford that, you could bring two pigeons. You could bring two doves. His kindness is so much greater than we give him credit for. He's not a lesser God, and our sin didn't somehow get lessened in its effect, but because of his great love, he's willing to accept a lesser offering. What kind of God cuts our bill to make sure we get forgiven? And we keep acting like it's too much. He's asking for too much. He wants too much. You don't understand. You don't know what it's like. You don't this and you don't that. And this is the God we serve. He says, I'll let a sheep cover your blood, your sin. And then he says, but if you can't afford a sheep, bring two doves. Why would we ever think him harsh? Why would we ever be afraid of him? Why would we ever think that we could somehow want him more than he wants us? But then it keeps going. In verse 11, God says, but if you cannot afford to bring two turtle doves or two young pigeons, you may bring two quarts of choice flour for your sin offerings. We are sinners and God keeps making a way for us. But at the same time, the enemy keeps telling us to be afraid of God, to hide our sin, that he's going to get tired of us, that we might lose our salvation, that he's stern and harsh. But here's God telling Israel that he desires to forgive them so much that if they can't afford a sheep, bring some doves. And if you can't afford some doves, bring some flour. Because God delights in mercy and he had determined to give forgiveness. And that's what makes him holy. Because if holiness was what we've been told it was, God would have sat up high and he would have said, I'll accept a sheep and nothing more than a sheep. But instead, God came down low and said, I'll take a sheep if you've got one, but if you don't, bring me two doves. And if you can't bring that, bring me some flour, because it's my heart to forgive your sin. It's my heart to make you my people. It's my heart to love you in a way you don't know that you're loved. How great is this God? He wants to forgive us. He wants to redeem us. He wants to be with us, and he wants us to be with him. I'll be honest, Leviticus 5 sort of blew my mind these last couple of weeks because it just doesn't make sense. And yet we keep acting like it's a lot. I keep hearing people say, you know, it's hard to be a Christian. Read Leviticus 5. Every time we say it's hard, he says, okay, do this. I'll take the weight. I'll take the difficulty. It's hard to surrender. As Joanne's been saying, you know what's hard? Not surrendering. Because Psalm 32 is just a picture. The beginning is just a picture of what an unsurrendered life looks like. The hand of God will crush your bones because he wants you to come to repentance. It's not hard to give our lives to God. It's hard to try to get God to work in lives that we haven't given him. Last passage, turn to Hebrews chapter 10. The chapter begins by saying that the law was just a shadow of the good things to come instead of the true form of the reality. So that means that the law was preparing us for something more, was preparing us for something greater. That's what all of Hebrews is about, honestly. Everything that Hebrews writes about then says, but Jesus is better. Angels, Jesus is better. Priests, Jesus is better. The law, Jesus is better. The blood of Abel, Jesus is better. Everything that Hebrews talks about just says Jesus is better. So now in this section, in Hebrews 10, it's explaining how the law had purpose, but its purpose was to be a shadow of the even better things that were going to come. Verses 3 and 4 say this, but in these sacrifices, so remember this, these are the sacrifices that we're reading about in Leviticus. In these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year, for it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. Man, I hope I can explain this the way it makes sense to me, in a way that makes sense to you. The offerings that God said he was willing to accept were impossible to cover our sin. Impossible to make them enough, but God called them acceptable. It is impossible for these things to make you clean, but I will accept these things from you. God's saying, because he is not willing that any should perish, because he is long-suffering, because he desires for everyone to be saved, because he delights in mercy, because he wants to forgive us, because he wants to be with us and for us to be with him. And so even obedience to Leviticus was impossible for them to make you whole. But God said, but I'll call you whole. Why? Because Jesus is coming. Because there is a day, there is a moment, the day that I have made, as Psalm 118 says, that I know the day that all of this will finally be washed away. Because when Jesus came, he offered his body as an offering for sin. His blood once for all dealt with all the sin of all the sinners. So this means that the blood of the sacrifices was not enough to pay for our sin, but God accepted it as a down payment. God accepted it as a placeholder for the day when he would send Jesus, and Jesus would finally pay once and for all. So yeah, it couldn't make you whole, but it could wait until wholeness came. It could not wash your sins away, but God said, I'll put it on your account until the day that I come and pay for it all. It's God saying, I want you so desperately that even what can't do it, I'll accept it until the day my son comes and does it all. How good is God that thousands of years earlier, he's willing to say, this will not do it, but I'll call it good because I know my son is coming. The God who wanted Israel wants us. And he wants us all. And so he made a way where there was no way. He offered forgiveness. We didn't ask for it. He offered redemption. We didn't work for it. He came to us. We did not come to him. That's God's holiness. That's God's heart. And so my question for us tonight, in the middle of all of this talk of Leviticus and sacrifices and Exodus and all of this, is really simple. Will we trust him? Will we come to God as he has called for us, offering our hearts and our lives, our hurts and our hopes, offering ourselves because we are not our own. We were made with the purpose of fellowship, and Jesus has paid the price to purchase us for himself. And so here's where we are. If there is sin, will we finally confess it? If there is sin in our lives, will we finally acknowledge it, repent of it, and let the blood of Jesus free us from it so that we can be in the relationship with God that he desires, not the one that our hidden sin has caused us to settle for? And again, that's what Diane was praying about earlier, that we are saved but not reconciled, that there are places in us that we have asked him to forgive us of all of our sins, but we haven't trusted him to take ownership of our hearts and of our lives. If that's the relationship that we're willing to settle for, we don't understand why Jesus died. He died to make us whole, not for us to go to heaven. If there are fears that we have hidden, are we ready to voice them, to no longer let them have control of our lives, but to come boldly before the throne of grace and ask for the mercy that we are all in need of? Are we ready to seek first the kingdom of God by decreasing so he can increase, by putting our hearts in his hands so that as much as God has been with us, we can finally be with God, so that as much as he has been our God, we can fully and forever be his people? Are we ready to trust God's holiness? If we are, then tonight there's a few easy things to do. Easy in that he's already made a way. Let's confess our sins. Let's submit our hearts. Let's surrender our lives. And let's be the people of God. He has made a way. It's time for us to walk in. Would you bow your heads with me? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, thank you tonight. As we have heard, as we have sung so many times in our lives, thank you that you've made a way where there seems to be no way. Thank you tonight that it's your desire that every part of me belong to you. Thank you for your kindness and your patience. Thank you for your redemption. Thank you that it was impossible for me to be redeemed, and you redeemed me. Thank you that I could not change and you changed me. God, I pray tonight that you would search us and know our hearts. I pray that you would test us and know our anxious thoughts. I pray that you would not just see if, I pray that you'd show us the wicked ways that are in us. Because there are. And I pray that you'd lead us in the way everlasting. I pray tonight that we would trust you. When Isaiah trusted you, he said, "Here am I, send me." When Peter trusted you, he followed you and gave up everything. When Zacchaeus trusted you, he said, "I don't need any of this anymore." And so I pray tonight that you and I, that we would lay down all the stuff we've carried. I pray that you would teach us to trust you. I pray that we would confess our sin. And I pray that you would change our hearts. I pray that we would be reconciled to God. I know we're spread out tonight, but as we finish, I'm just going to ask, would you find somebody to pray with? And I just want us to pray simply tonight, and then I'll close us. Just pray for the courage and the grace to trust God with everything, to surrender everything into the hands of God. Just find somebody to pray with. Let's take 2 minutes to pray, and then I'll close us out. Heavenly Father, I thank you tonight for your holiness. Thank you for your holy invitation to be your children. Thank you for making a way for our sin to be not just forgiven, but to be dealt with. Thank you for making a way for us to be new creations, where old things pass away and all things become new. Thank you that not only is our sin washed away, but somehow by Jesus, who by him who knew no sin, becoming sin, we now have been called the righteousness of God. And so I thank you tonight for loving us more than we've ever imagined. I thank you tonight for doing all the work and supplying everything we need to be redeemed. I thank you that your kindness draws us to repentance. I pray that we would be a people who trust you, a people of surrender and submission, a people who hold nothing back, who cling to nothing, a people who say day in and day out, not my will, but yours be done. A people who are reconciled to God over and over and over again. Because you are worthy to be trusted. You are worthy to be loved. You are worthy to be obeyed. Thank you for paying our price that we could be called your children. Just want to finish tonight sort of as a benediction with the new song of Revelation chapter 5. Worthy are you to take the scroll and open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made us a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you guys are still praying together, please continue. Don't let me stop you. If you need to go, feel free to go. God bless you guys. See you again next week.